He's very patient. I don't know if you noticed, he mentions many times in the Bible things that we need to do. And he mentions the same thing several times. Some of us are slow learners, and that would include me. But we said that in the last one, the Passover was about the last plague on the Egyptian people, and also the Israelites, if they weren't listening, was the angel of death would come over and take the firstborn male from every family. Unless there was a sacrifice of a lamb offered and the blood was put on the door. And the people inside had to eat the lamb, in other words, take it all in, what was going on. And that had to take place. And when you read about the Passover laws, the lamb was actually picked days before, and it had to be a lamb without blemish. And they actually took it in their homes and they examined it for that week. And then it was presented on the Passover day for its sacrifice, its killing. And then the next morning they had to be ready to go. And that's how it happened. We talked about, last week was Palm Sunday, about it was almost like the Jewish people picked the ultimate Passover lamb. Remember John the Baptist said once, "Behold the Lamb of God," looking at Jesus, "who comes to take away the sin of the world." Meaning, we're supposed to die for our sins. But God said he would accept a substitute. And all through the Old Testament, they would have a scapegoat or a lamb that was killed every year to die in the place of them for their sins. So you had to literally watch something die for what you had done, what I had done. But that was all temporary. It's just something in God's grace that he accepted, because they were never really without blemish, and they were animal sacrifices, and so they were temporary. But the Bible says once and for all, God became flesh, lived a sinless life, so he was without blemish, and he became our sacrificial lamb. And so for all those other lambs that were sacrificed the day that Jesus was, remember it was on Passover day that he was killed, it was pointless for all those others to die, because only one true sacrifice would do. Once and for all, the Bible says. And so, how many of you know that today is Resurrection Day, and when the ladies went to the tomb, if you were there this morning, the tomb was what? Empty. It was borrowed because they didn't need it long. Right? It was just going to be a temporary holding place. And you know that when they got there, the stone had been rolled away, not to let Jesus out, but to let people see in what was going on. And that's what the Sunday school lesson was about. But what I want to talk about this morning is the examination that Jesus had during that week. And so let's pray and get started talking about that. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us. We praise you and just love you, Father, for loving us so much. Lord, we know we're not good at it yet, but we want to get better at it and love you. Lord, you said if we really loved you, we'd obey you. And because we trust you, we knew you enough to know that you're always right and you always want the best for us. So I pray, Father, again, we get better at that. I pray in this examination process, Lord, that we learn. We go from areas of more doubt and not understanding to areas of faith, Lord, and greater understanding. And Lord, that it would change our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Most of you know that when you talk about the four Gospels, three of them are very much alike, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They pretty much follow the same pattern. They're called the Synoptic Gospels, because what they are is three different witnesses saying, when this happened, this is what I saw. And they line up. They're not exactly alike, because no two witnesses see or say the same thing about what they see. Right? If you ask four people what happened in a wreck, you're going to get perspectives from four different ways. But it's all the truth. And so you see that in the three Synoptic Gospels. When John, the apostle, got older, he went back and he focused in on parts that people were misunderstanding in their reading of the first three. And then he also focused in a lot on the final week or 2 weeks of Jesus' life. And so the book of John has 21 chapters. Starting in chapter 11 is Lazarus' resurrection. And then the next chapter, we talk about the coming in on Palm Sunday. So we're just talking about a few days from the last half of the book of John. So he's really focusing in on this time. The next chapter, you know, he goes on and on about him clearing the temple. And so, think of it, if Palm Sunday was them saying, this is the lamb that we choose to be our sacrifice, then for the next week they would examine. And what did they see Jesus do? Well, he came in, he rode the donkey in, the king coming in peace, we talked about that. And the next thing you know, he goes to the temple, and what does he find going on in the temple? There's money changers have been playing financial games and political games and all that kind of stuff. Now, if you wanted to get to know Jesus, you could see how he was about his Father's house. He said, my Father's house was supposed to be a place of prayer, and look what you turned it into. And so he overturned the money changers' tables and all those kind of things. So if you were, came in and were new to the area, you saw, look what was going on at the temple of church, and you saw this money going around, and then you saw Jesus come in and say, no, this isn't it. Then you would be examining, you would be getting to know this Jesus guy, wouldn't you? It's not about church games, right? And that took place. And he went on, and then sometimes the scribes and Pharisees would try to corner him up and say, what about this and what about that? And he would give an answer every time that kind of left them speechless. They didn't know what to do with it. In fact, he asked them a question during that week, and they didn't know how to answer it. And he just walked on. And different people he healed, different people he talked to, all of those things in that week, then he examined Jesus. He taught in the temple. In his the history we have of Jesus, he only spent one night in Jerusalem, even though it was the high place to be. That's where the temple was, the Temple Mount. And it was the night that he was captured and taken and held on. The other nights he would leave out of Jerusalem, go up past Bethany to past Bethesda to Bethany, spend the night there and come back. Well, that week they got to see. They got to hear. They got to see what happened when he was poked and prodded. They got to see what he was like whenever he was being hailed as king. And they got to see what he was like when people were just really didn't like him and questioned him every which way. And then one night, they got their heads together. By the way, you go read about it, Judas, for 30 pieces of silver, sold out his supposed friend and leader. And later, if you remember, he went and he wound up throwing that 30 pieces of silver into the temple. And what did the people say who conspired to kill him? We can't take that money because it's blood money. Now, where did he get the money? We can't take it because it's money paid for somebody's debt. We can't take it. Where did the money come from? For out of their hands. Right? How crazy was that? So it's too dirty for us to touch, even though we paid it to get it done that way. We made it dirty, but we can't touch it now. And he went out and bought a potter's field. So everything was really messed up. A lot of confusion about what religion was. Let me go ahead and give you some advice. When you get confused about religion, forget religion and go to Jesus. Amen? Religiously, we need to learn to love Jesus, but forget what the man-made side of it and go to Jesus and do what he says to do. Well, if you remember, they went to, and they found him on the Garden of Gethsemane, which is down the hill from the Mount of Olives. Just before you cross the valley, go back up to Jerusalem. A little spot on the side of the hill, and he was doing his prayer, and the soldiers came out to get him, led by the priest guys and all the priest guys, if you can imagine that, going to arrest him. Judas went and kissed him and said, this is the guy. And so they came up, and by the way, Jesus had stepped out. They didn't go find him hiding in a hole. When they came up the hill, he stepped out and said, who are you seeking? They said, we're seeking Jesus of Nazareth. He says, I am him. You know what they did? They fell back. The soldiers did. Because Jesus, because he was well known for using a sword and a machine gun. Is that right? No. He knew a lot of kung fu and other tricks. No, he didn't need none of those kind of things. And yet they were afraid of him. And they fell back. He says, who are y'all for? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He says, I'm him. Finally, they got enough courage together that they got up and, of course, made Peter mad and took a sword and started swinging at him. Dr. Luke gives us the medical version. He cut off one of his ear, and Jesus did the medical thing and stuck it back on. You know, how many of us was going to arrest him after we'd seen all that happen? But anyway, they did, and they were so afraid of this peaceful man that they tied him up and marched him back to the other side. And the examination started. Again, we're examining too. We're doing an investigation of this Jesus, aren't we? Who was he? And how was these things happen? Let me start off by saying Jesus was not a victim. Okay? Jesus was not a victim. Jesus was a warrior. And he was battling that night. And this was his secret plan. You ever heard of somebody who breaks into prison? It's kind of what Jesus was doing. He was breaking into the place that the guys who were taking him in thought that he was what? Their victim. We got him. We got him conquered. And Jesus is there saying, this is all part of the plan. And in fact, I can verify that for you. Let me find it. John chapter 10, verse 18 says, no one takes it from me. He's talking about his life. No one takes it from me. I lay it down myself. Who was in control? Who stepped out and said, who are you looking for? Jesus, it's me. Does that sound like a victim? Not at all. He says, no one can take my life from me. I lay it down myself. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. Who's in charge? This is chapter 10, right? Let's go back to chapter 18, and where we're going to be talking about the other things. He says, this is all part of the master plan. So he's taken. He's kept overnight. He's beaten. They decided that they can't do anything with it. The high priest and the other ones, Annas and Caiaphas, are all talking to him, and they can't win. No matter how much they beat him, no matter how much they ridicule him. So the next morning they decide, we just got to get rid of him. And so they're going to take him to the Roman governor, Pilate, and say, we need to get rid of this guy for us. They didn't say it that way, but they said, we can't execute, you can. And Pilate wants nothing to do with it. Now, Pilate is a wily politician. Slick. I know y'all never heard of a slick politician before, but this guy, you couldn't believe him very much. He was mean as a snake. He was a politician. And he was a bureaucrat also. In other words, he did what the higher-ups said, and that way, that's how you moved up in that world. And he was in a little bitty place that was known to be a headache for anybody to go and run, but sent from Rome over there, and here's what they wanted. They wanted the Pax Romana. How many of y'all have seen a good Pax Romana lately? Pax Romana meant this. Peace of Rome. You were a good bureaucrat. If you sent the tax money, we sent you over there to get, and we didn't hear about no problems. That's the peace they talked about. Don't tell us no problems. That's double negative, bad English. If you have a problem, you're not a good bureaucrat, and you won't be promoted. And that was what it was about. And so, here he is, wakes up on this particular day, this Friday, before daylight, and he goes out there, and all these guys got a little mob going. He didn't want that morning, right? He didn't want it at all. And yet, here it is, on his doorstep. And so what does the Bible say happened? He's going to also get to examine Jesus. He's going to get to examine the Lamb, the one, the ultimate one for that Passover. And who is this? You call him an agnostic or an atheist. He didn't know what to believe. He probably heard about all this kind of stuff. How many people do you know in our culture nowadays that they've heard about religion, but they really don't know what to believe? They hear from this one, they hear from that one. They don't know what to believe. And so what we want to tell them is go examine Jesus, and that's what he's going to get to do. So they, that's the priests, led Jesus from Caiaphas to the Praetorium. That's where Pilate lived. And it was early morning, and they themselves did not go into the Praetorium, lest they should be defiled. These guys who had conspired and paid somebody to commit murder couldn't go into a Gentile place because that would defile them. That would make them dirty. You see the ridiculousness of this conspiracy? And they didn't want to be defiled so they could go eat the Passover. They needed the Passover, amen? They needed something to take their place for their sins. Pilate then went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? I like how they did in this version of the Bible. You see that man is capitalized. We know which man they're talking about. I said, what are you charging this guy with? And they answered and said to him, if he were not an evildoer, we wouldn't be delivering to him. In other words, just take our word for it. Go kill him. That's what they're saying. Pilate said to him, you take him in judgment according to your law. Therefore the Jews said to him, it's not lawful for us to put anybody to death. Besides that, we get our hands dirty and we're not into that. Especially when we're being very religious. Again, this is a ridiculous argument. But it was against the law for them. Only the Roman governor was supposed to kill somebody. Of course, they forgot that when they executed James and also Stephen. That the saying that Jesus might be fulfilled which he spoke, signifying by what death he would die. He had already said that he would be hung up and it meant on a tree, which would be on a cross. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again, called Jesus, and said to him, "Are you king of the Jews?" I mean, all this nonsense they're talking about, which means nothing to me, but it's really irritating this early in the morning. You got to make a cause of stink. It's going to get me in trouble with my superiors, so just tell me. He says, "Are you king of the Jews?" Jesus answered and said, "Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you about this concerning me?" You know, it seems Jesus had a way to cut through the whole chase and see what was going on. It seems almost like he was being smart, and he wasn't. He was saying, "Are you going to make up your own mind about this, or are you going to listen to what other people say?" Again, in our culture, how many people make up their own mind about who Jesus is? Or just listen to the prevailing whatever it is for the day? And so he says, "Are you thinking for yourself, or are you just listening to other people?" Pilate answers, says, "Am I a Jew? I've talked to people before about, are you going to heaven or not?" And they'll look at him and tell me what denomination they go to. It's not my question. What does the Bible say it takes to go to heaven? Be this denomination or that denomination? No. It says, I knew that you were waiting for when I would say it. Romans 10:9. What does it say in Romans 10:9? This is what it takes to go to heaven. If you confess with your mouth, in other words, not what he asked Pilate, are you speaking for somebody else? You're speaking for yourself. See, if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is your Lord. Remember, Lord meaning ultimate authority, the one I listen to first. Okay? And believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And if you've done that, you're my brother and sister in Christ, no matter what the name on the church door is. Right? And so he says, "Am I a Jew?" He throws a religious cliche at it. "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and high priest have delivered you to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered and says, "My kingdom's not of this world." Now, this really doesn't affect you as far as your political situation. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight. So there'd be a big riot going on right now. That's not happening. So that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Pilate therefore said to him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus answered and said, "You say rightly that I'm a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." He says, "I'm here to tell people the truth. Cut through everything else and tell them the truth. Yes, I'm a king, but it's nothing that has to do with your dimension or what you're thinking of." And then Pilate says this. This is really a tough. You can see Pilate's thinking. He's not stupid. He's not nice, but he's not stupid. This is what he says when he's thinking. Pilate said to him, "What is truth? What is truth?" I mean, these guys come and wake me up early in the morning. That's their truth. I got an answer to my higher ups. That's their truth. I mean, there's all these different truths out there. He's very cynical about the whole deal. And the truth is, speaking of truth, we can all be cynical about different people's truth. We need to choose which truth we're going to put first. I can tell you, truths have changed a lot. Have you noticed that? What was true in the 60s when I was a little kid is not true today. I'm afraid my mom would be up for child abuse because she spanked me more than once in a store in front of God and everybody. But we learned not to play with toys. We picked up something that didn't belong to us, or you didn't even think about being rude, and you didn't say no to mama in a way that she perceived as disrespectful. Yeah, but she was abusive. But that was the truth back then. You do it today, what do they get? Somebody's calling 911 and taking videos. You fixed to be famous or infamous, aren't you? It's a different truth. It's a different truth. And you know what? We got to cut through and find out what is truth. And so he said, "What is truth?" And when he said this, he went out again to the Jews and said, "Listen to what he said. I've examined him. I find no fault in him at all. He's been on trial, and what was he declared? Innocent. But he's a politician, so he's going to find a way to get himself out of trouble, he thinks. He says, "But you have a custom that I should release somebody to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" And they all cried, says, "Not this man, Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber. In other places, it says he was a murderer. We talked about that this morning at our sunrise service. Listen, Jesus' tomb was not the only empty tomb on Sunday morning. Did you know that? Lazarus' tomb was empty. He had already died, used the tomb for about 4 days or so, to the point where they said, "He stinketh," in the King James. And what happened? Jesus emptied that tomb. Lazarus came forth, and that was taken care of. Barabbas was supposed to be in a grave that day. Barabbas, and listen, was Barabbas a good guy? Lazarus seemed like a pretty good guy. Sisters were nice, right? But what about Barabbas? He was a robber. He was a murderer. He was a troublemaker. And everybody knew it. Jesus was just, what, 4 or 5 days before? Everybody was heading to come into town and seeing him do miracles and all that kind of stuff. I'm sure Barabbas thought, they're not going to pick me. I'm not going to win this contest. And yet when he stepped up to there, what happened? I'm glad you asked. I'm glad I got a book. But they picked two. They picked Barabbas. It won't live up to who Jesus was. Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. That meant they took a whip with all kind of junk in the leather and basically ripped the skin off of Jesus' back. They would typically give one less lash than what they considered a death penalty. That's how badly he was beaten in the process. He'd already been beaten in his face with the soldiers and all. And we're going to talk about that some more. While he's waiting for all this stuff going on, the soldiers twisted the crown of thorns, put it on his head, and they put him in a purple robe, messing with him. "You're a king? I heard you say you're a king? Here's your crown." You've got kind of a picture over there. There's some native citrus around here. If you go in the woods, you'll find thorns about that long on it. They use it sometimes to graft the other citrus on the top of it because it's native to the area. But the thorns about that long. You can't imagine, I guess you can, just somebody putting that on your head and just pushing it down. And then they would do things like blindfold him and hit him. And while he was blindfolded, they said, "Now prophesy, which one of us hit you?" Just really horrible stuff going on. And put the purple robe because it was a yellow color. And they would say, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they struck him with their hands. The Bible says that he was unrecognizable by the time he started to take his cross up the hill. Pilate then went out and said, "Behold, I'm bringing him out to you again. And that you may know that I find what? No fault in my examining." This is twice he's declaring him what? Innocent. Jesus came out and wearing the crown of thorns and purple robe. Pilate said to him, "Behold the man, unrecognizable, beaten to a pulp." And he's trying to do what? Build sympathy so he can let him go and his own conscience be clear. Better he be beat up than be killed in the worst possible way they could think of on the cross. "Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out again, saying," what? "Not good enough. Crucify. Execute him on that cross. Make him suffer. Humiliate him." They stripped him naked on the cross and they hung him until they suffocated themselves because they couldn't pull themselves up anymore. Humiliate this guy because he's a threat to us and to our way, to our truth. We got to get rid of this guy. "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to him, "You take him and crucify him. I find no fault in him." That's three times what? He's been declared what? Innocent. And if you go back a little further, go read the other Gospels, at one time he was taken to see Herod Antipas, the governor over the northern area, and he tried to talk to him, and he said, "I don't find anything wrong with him either." That's four times he's been declared innocent in examining. And by the way, we're examining that sacrificial lamb to find out if there's a what? A blemish. And every time they looked and said, "I find no fault," they said, "Find no blemishes that would qualify him to be the perfect sacrificial lamb, the perfect substitute for those of us who have sin, to be offset by someone who didn't have sin." Then Jesus answered and said, "We have a law. According to the law, he ought to die." The Jews said to him, "Because he made himself the Son of God." Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was more afraid. He says, "I'm not going to win this. I thought I was a slick enough politician to get out of this and have some semblance of conscience for an innocent man," but he got more for it. And went back into the praetorium, into the building, and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" Jesus gave him the answer. Gave him no answer, excuse me. And Pilate said to him, "Are you not speaking to me?" Do you not know that I have the power to crucify you and the power to release you? I refer you back to John chapter 10. He says, nobody takes my life from me. I give it up willingly. And I also have the power to lay it down. And I have the power to take it back up. So he gives him that answer. He says, Jesus says, you can have no power at all against me unless it were given to you from above. Supernatural power. He says, I'm not talking about at the head office at Rome with Caesar. I'm talking about from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me to you has greater sin. The little religious group who conspired for murder, who bribed for murder, he said they have greater sin than you. However, remember, if you fall off the 50th floor of a high-rise building or the 100th floor, which one are you more dead when you hit the bottom? It's about the same, isn't it? You're just as dead whichever floor you fell off of. Even though 50 is only halfway up. So you may have more problems, as it's put there, delivered has greater sin, but if you're in hell, you're in hell for eternity, right? And so it doesn't help a lot. From then on, Pilate sought to release him. Pilate sought to release him. Quick commercial break. This afternoon, we're in the chapter of Daniel where the Easter story is told. Okay? And so it's amazing enough that it happens to fall on Easter in our study of the book of Daniel. But the Easter story will be told tonight in the book of Daniel, in the story about the lion's den. And you'll be able to see it pretty clearly. So if you miss it this morning or the first service, or you want to hear how the Easter story is told in the book of Daniel, come see us at 5 o'clock tonight. Okay, end of commercial. By the way, if you come at night, there's no offering to play past at night. So it's a cheap commercial. From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, if you let this man go, you're no friend of Caesar's. The big boss, if you kill you, the one you're trying to impress to get up and have a good retirement and all that kind of stuff. You're no friend of Caesar's. Whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar. It didn't matter that Jesus was speaking against God in their mind. Now they're saying he speaks against Caesar. When Pilate therefore heard that say, he brought Jesus out, sat down at the judgment seat, a place called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the preparation day for Passover, and the sixth hour, it's the beginning of noon on that day, and he said to the Jews, behold your king. And they cried out, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, shall I crucify your king? He didn't get it. How does this work with this good bunch of church people? And what are they crying out? Kill the innocent one. And this is what the religious group said. The chief priest says, we have no king but Caesar. Who was Lord of their life? Remember, confess your mouth. Jesus is number one. And they just confessed who was number one in their life. We have no king but Caesar. Were they headed for salvation? Were they headed for heaven? And they were okay with that as long as they got what they wanted in this world right now. I'm afraid our culture's that way. When do we want what we want? Now. Right? And listen, every one of us fight that, don't we? There's not a one of us that don't want what we want when we want. It's only when we submit lovingly and trusting to Jesus and say, but not my will, but thine, that we really treat him like Lord. And he delivered him to be crucified. So they took Jesus and led him away. They did what? He was found innocent, then he was found innocent, then he was found innocent, then he was found innocent. Right? Three times by Pilate and once by Herod. And of course the guys who set him up knew he was innocent. And so that definitely deserved execution, right? How crazy is that? How crazy is that? But that's exactly what happened. And then he buried his cross, went to a place of the skull, which is in Hebrew called Golgotha. And he was killed. He was killed exactly like this hero, special forces warrior planned. Amen? Like he planned it long ago, because the Bible says on the bottom here, the wages of sin is death, or what we earn with our sin, going against God just once. Even though I've done it many times and I'm not proud of that, I'm just telling you the truth. It'd be not a good place to tell lies, right? How many of us have sinned before? The Bible says all of us. It's on that plaque over there. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We would miss hell by our sin. Just one would do it. So it says the punishment or wages of sin is death. It has to be paid or we hit hell. And the only way that we would miss hell is if we were perfect. And if you're perfect, you don't need to worry about being here. Why? By the way, there was only one, and he was well examined. He found innocent, right? Or somebody pays our penalty for us. And that's what the warrior, the non-victim, Jesus Christ did. He stepped forward and says, I got a plan. It's been kept secret, but it's coming to happen right now. You may look like I'm losing, but I'm winning. And who gets the victory for him winning the battle? We do. Resurrection Day ought to be an amazing day of celebration. It ought to be, we make a big deal out of Christmas. Christmas is wonderful. That's when he stepped in to start his plan, right? To start his plan on earth. But Resurrection Day is the victory day. If you dance, and I know a lot of Baptists don't, and it's not against the rules. We're just not good at it. You know? But if you dance, it'd be the day to dance. It's Resurrection Day. It's the victory. How do I get that message across to me first so that it will overflow for me and go to others? Why don't we live in victory? What stops us from letting it change our whole outlook on life? When the worst thing that we think can happen to us is the death to ourselves, the death to a loved one, the death to this one and that one, and yet death has been defeated if we just do one thing. Make Jesus of the Bible and everything that he is the Lord of our life. But now the victory's there, and we know it's there, and we go over again, we rehearse it again. Hopefully it changed our mind enough that we recognize not only is it for us, but it's for everybody we hand it to. For everybody who comes and examines Jesus like this guy did, and I would love to tell you that one day Pilate woke up and says, I saw an innocent man, and he had to be. I know the captain of the guard that had him killed, looked up and said, true, this is the Son of God. Another place he said, truly, this man was innocent. What was he innocent of? They called him blasphemous because he said he was the Son of God. Well, he was innocent of blasphemy because Jesus said, truly, this is the Son of God. And if you remember, they treated him about like a lamb because the lambs, they would bleed. They didn't want the blood of an animal left in them. And remember when Jesus died, what did they do? They came and they examined him again. They really examined him that week, and he said, he's dead. And they said, what? Well, stick a spear in his side. And they did. The water and the blood came out. They bled him just like a sacrificial lamb. Not a bone was broken, also like a sacrificial lamb. It's amazing how many things just line perfectly up. And that much coincidence, we spell what? Capital G-O-D. God set this up. And then he was taken down, and he's put in a tomb for a couple of days, and he did better than Houdini ever could because they had the stone roll, they had the seal on it, they had the guards, they had all that kind of stuff, and still Jesus got out. Death couldn't hold him. He beat him. Let me ask you, church, is that good news? I was reading this week. Did you know there's as much extra biblical documentation, that means outside of the Bible, not just the Bible, not just the witnesses, not just all these people for all these centuries who have said, I've seen this miracle and this miracle and this miracle, but extra biblical, there's plenty of documentation about the historical Jesus. Movie out now, The Case for Christ. I'm looking forward to seeing it, where they go back and they say, agnostics, people who aren't sure, examine Jesus like Pilate did, and they find evidence to say, wow, this is true. Well, if it's true, then we're kind of like Pilate. We have to make a decision. Did Pilate want that decision that morning? He wanted to go on like he always had. But the truth is, once faced with Jesus, you have to make a decision. And Pilate made the wrong one. Better to go along, get along, and go along, as opposed to what? Take the stand. This morning, our challenge is Jesus Lord of our lives? Or is the circumstances, or political, or financial, or cultural issues of the day? What is Lord of our life? If you're ready to say, Jesus is my Lord, He is always right. He can see yesterday from tomorrow. He's got things prepared for me that my heart, mind, and ears and never seen, never heard. He's got things like that planned for me, waiting for me. All I have to do is say yes. So this morning on Resurrection Sunday, if you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, you can this morning. And instead of being on death row, you'll be taken off death row. They call that dead man walking, and you put on life's robe. Lamb and the name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And you don't have to worry about what happens to the body anymore. Because what? Get a new one. It lasts a lot better than this thing. Amen? It lasts a lot better than this one. No pain, no more suffering. And so that's the invitation. Join Jesus. Follow Jesus. If you follow him, you wind up where he is. So let's stand and pray.